the antidote to Lear, where Lear ends with no hope whatsoever and Pericles ends like a fairy tale with the storyteller. I mean, if I could be involved in a production like that where everybody is a collective group of storytellers, that would be my dream. It just looked like so much fun.
I'm glad you're here, Eden Lee.
I think Trevor Young, Trevor Nunn's show was recently too, and like 3 or 4 years ago. So it must have been very recently presented anyway.
Yeah.
Okay, so the next two we're missing are Mike and Leilani. Mike, I have scheduled as the first fisherman, and Lysimachus, I hope I pronounced that right.
Lysimachus?
Lysimachus?
Lysimachus. The emphasis is on the second syllable. Lysimachus?
Okay. Lysimachus, okay.
Lysimachus. Lysimachus.
Lysimachus. All right, well, we'll be correcting Mike a lot, I guess, from the sound of it. And then he's also playing Pandar, the crazy guy in the later act, and also Leonine, who has a part in which he wants to kill Marina, much like in Snow White movie.
Oh, you froze, Jim.
Marina, that would be Leilani, and she should be showing up shortly. What's that question?
Oh, I said you froze for a second.
Oh, okay. That was Leilani as Marina. I'm looking at the script over here. Let's see. What roles are you playing?
Okay, I have the role of Helicanus.
Helicanus.
One of the lords of Tyre.
Mm-hmm.
And he's apparently a good buddy of Pericles, or one of his, pretty much of a confidant type person.
Okay.
And I'm the second fisherman, and I guess the other seconds, are we doing all seconds?
We'll see what that entails as we go through. I want Una to get her share of some of the others too. So we'll go from there.
And the other one I picked up was
one of Paul's.
Yeah, he's the... Oh, gosh, let's... Well, I have Kermion. Kermion? Kermion.
Saruman is what I had. He's the faith healer and heals Tyza at the end. And Paul is here, but I guess he's leaving us as soon as we get started. So I'm playing the third fisherman, and also Bolt, B-O-U-L-T. Is that the spelling? And it's such an odd to not be four or five syllables to his name is kind of odd. Oh, and Una, I think you're going to take Linda's role back and play all of those that are originally written for you.
Okay.
Is that good?
Yeah.
Okay, can you tell us what those are?
Lycordia. Diana and Philemon.
Philemon, yes. Is that correct, Eden?
Yep.
It sounds right. Philemon. Okay. Ruby, what you got? Oh, you got the Wicked Queen.
Don't take your sons to town.
You're muted, Ruby.
Can you hear us, Ruby?
Yeah, she's muted. Here, ask
on. I mute myself because I don't want to create noise while I was sitting up. Sorry. I get to play some evil characters here. I'm playing Dionysa, and she's Dionysa. Dionysa.
Here you go.
Which is a blend of the evil stepmother in Cinderella and queen of Snow White. She's just the epitome of evil. Yeah. And then I get to play Baud. And
Baud.
She's probably neck and neck for evil. She's in charge of the brothel and all of the occupants. And if one of these poor souls gets in the maternal way and it delivers, she's in charge of that, and they make sure when it's old enough, it will be part of their troupe. It'll be part of the brothel, right? So she's completely, she's wicked, wicked, wicked.
Well, you got two wicked roles.
Yes.
Keith.
Not out of the musical, though.
Should we give Mike a call or Leilani? See where they are?
You got your phone? I just put mine all the way on the side of the room.
Oh, I see. Okay. Well, I'd like to start. Paul, since you're here, would you read the first fisherman? Okay.
Jim?
Yes?
Was Leilani going to read Marina?
Yes.
I played Marina 30 years ago at Harvard. I don't mind reading that one.
Okay. If she doesn't show up, she's not going to be on stage for another half hour, maybe.
Right.
But
this just as a fallback.
Yes. Good. Good. I'm always ready for that. I'm hoping. But usually they have a glitch with Zoom or something. So if that takes care of that, I don't know.
I just her, so I hope she.
Oh, you're going to call her? Okay, great. That's a good idea.
Yeah.
So what we're doing tonight is the opening scene. Gower explains why. Is it Joanna or is it John?
John Gower.
John, okay. She will read the first 14 lines there, and then we'll skip over to Act Two after the dumb show. So what you really need to do, everybody, is just look at Act Two. It's the beginning with Gower speaking, and we'll go from there, because she can... you can just sit back and watch Eden Lee in her first 14 lines.
So that's Act Two, not Act One, right?
Yes, we're not doing Act One at all.
Okay. And okay.
Does that explain a whole bunch of stuff?
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. We're coming into Act Two immediately after the 14 lines.
Okay.
All right. And if our fisherman number two will sit down, we will start with the play. Okay, let's give Eden Lee a head start here. Here she is as Gower.
Song that old was sung, from ashes ancient Gower is come, assuming man's infirmity to glad your ear and please your eyes. It hath been sung at festivals on ember eves and holy days, and lords and ladies in their lives have read it for restoratives. The purchase is to make men glorious, et bonum quo antiquius so melius. If you, born in these latter times, when wits more ripe accept my rhymes, and that to hear an old man sing may to your wishes pleasure bring. I life would wish, and that I might waste it for you like taper light. Good Helicane, that stayed at home not to eat honey like a drone from others' labors, for though he strive to kill in bad, keep good alive, and to fulfill his prince's desire, sends word of all that haps in Tyre. How Thaliard came, full bent with sin, and had intent to murder him, and that in Tarsus was not best longer for him to make his rest. He, doing so, put forth to seas, where when men bend, there's seldom ease. For now the winds begin to blow. Thunder above and deeps below make such unquiet that the ship should house him safe is racked and split. And he, good prince, having all lost, by waves from coast to coast is tossed. All perishing of man, of pelf, nay, aught escapant but himself, till fortune, tired with doing bad, threw him ashore to give him glad. And here he comes. What shall be next? Pardon, old Gower, this long's the text.
Pericles enters.
Yet cease your ire, you angry stars of heaven. Wind, rain, and thunder, remember earthly man, but it is a substance that men yield to you. And I, as fits my nature, do obey you. Alas, the seas hath cast me on the rocks, washed me from shore to shore, and left me breath, nothing to think on but ensuing death. Let it suffice the greatness of your powers to have bereft a prince of all his fortunes, and having thrown him from your watery grave, here to have death in peace is all he'll crave.
What ho, Pilch!
Ah, come and bring away the nets.
What, Patch? Ah, match, Patch Breach.
Oh, that's your line. I'm sorry. I jumped your line. What say you, master?
First look how thou stirrest now. Come away, or I'll fetch thee with a woman.
Faith, master. I was thinking of the poor man that were cast away before us even now.
Alas, poor souls, it grieves my heart to hear what pitiful cries they made to us to help them, when, well a day, we could scarce help ourselves.
Ah, nay, master, said one I as much when I saw the porpoise, and how he bounced and tumbled. They say that he's half fish and half flesh, a plague on them. They ne'er come none, but I have been washed. Master, I marveled at the fishes free in the sea. How are they to live in the sea?
Why, as men do a land, the great ones eat up the little ones. Compare our rich misers to nothing so filthy as a whale, a plays and tumbles, driving the poor fry before him, and at last devours all them at a mouthful. Such whales have I heard on the land, who never leave gaping till they swallow the whole parish, church, steeple, bells, and all.
A pretty moral.
But master, if I had been the season, I would have been that day in the belfry.
Why, man?
Why? Because he had swallowed me too. And when I had been in his belly, I would have kept such a laughing, a clanging of the bells, and that he should never have left until he cast bells, steeple, church, and parish up again. But that is the good King Simonides wrote of the mind. You were of my mind.
Simonides.
He would purge the land of these drones, and that robbed the bee of her honey.
Oh, how from the Phineas subject of the sea these fishes are the infirmities of men, and from the water empire recollect all the men may approve, or men be. Hello, Peter, honest fisherman. So, peace be at your labor, honest fisherman.
Honest good fellow, what's that? Okay. If it be a day fits you, search out of the calendar, and nobody look after it.
May see the sea hath cast upon your coat.
What a drunken knave was the sea to cast thee in our way.
Whom both the waters and the wind is for them to play upon. Entry. A man who both the waters and the wind in that vast tennis court hath made the ball for them to play upon, entreats you pity him. He asks of you that never used to beg.
So, friend, cannot you beg? Hear them in our country Greece gets more with begging than we do with working.
Canst thou catch any fishes then?
I never practiced it.
Nay, then thou wilt starve, sure. For here's nothing to be not got nowadays, unless thou canst fish for it.
What have I been, I have forgot to know. But what I am, want to teach ye to think on. A man thronged up with cold, my chill, and have no more life than may, and have no more of life than may suffice to give my tongue that here to ask your help, which, if you shall refuse, when I am dead, for that I am a man, pray you see me buried.
I quote it, how gods forbid. I have a gown here. Come, put it on. Keep thee warm. Thou afore me, a handsome fellow. Come, thou shalt go home, and we'll have flesh for holidays, fish for fasting days, and for puddings and flapjacks, and thou shalt be welcome.
I thank you, sir.
Hark you, my friend. You said you could not beg.
Well, I did but crave.
But crave? Then I'll turn craver, too. And so I shall scrape whipping.
Why? Are your beggars whipped, then?
Oh, not all, my friend, not all. But for all your beggars were whipped, I wish no better office than to be beetled. But, master, I'll go draw up the net.
How well this honest man, mirth becomes their labor.
Hark you, sir, do you know where you are?
Not well.
Why, I'll tell you. This is called Pentapolis, and our king, the good Simonides.
Simonides, do you call him? The good Simonides, do you call him?
Aye, sir, and he deserves to be called for his peaceful reign and good government.
Well, he is a happy king, since he gains from his subjects the name of good by his government. How far is the court distant from this shore?
Aye, sir, half a day's journey, and I'll tell you, he hath a fair daughter, and tomorrow is her birthday, and these, and there are princes and knights come all parts of the world just and tourney for her love.
Oh, were my fortunes equal to my desires, I could wish to make one there.
Oh, sir, things must be as they may, and what a man cannot get, he may lawfully deal for his wife's soul.
Oh, help, master, help! Here's a big fish hangs in the net, like a poor man's right in the law. 'twill hardly come out. Ha! Ah, boats on it, 'tis come at last, and 'tis turned to a rusty armor.
An armor, friends, I pray you, let me see it. Thanks, Fortune, yet that after all thy crosses, thou givest me somewhat to repair myself. And though it was mine own, part of my heritage, which my dead father did bequeath me, with this ship charged, even as he left his life. Keep it, my Pericles, it hath been a shield twixt me and death, and pointed to this brace, for that it saved me. Keep it, in like necessity, the which the gods protect thee from, may defend thee, is kept where I kept it, so dearly I loved it, so dearly loved it. 'Tis the rough sea that spares me, spares not any man. Took it in rage, though it calmed, had given it again. I thank thee for it. My shipwreck is now's no ill, since I have here my father gave in his will.
What mean you, sir?
Oh, to beg of you, kind friends, this coat of worth, for it is sometime target to a king. I know it by this mark. He loved me dearly, and for his sake, I wish to having of it, and that you wish that you guide me in your sovereign's court, where wish I may appear a gentleman, and if that ever, and if that ever my low fortune's better, I'll pay you bounties. Till then, rest your depth on.
But that's all right. All right, we're at Act 2, Scene 2.
I'm not going to check it. I'm just going to read it.
Read like a part of it already, and it looks like Mr. Matt Book is back. Is that Peter knocking on our door?
No. Nice brand.
I'm not going to check out. I'm just going to read. As long as you can hear me, that's okay.
You're cool.
You think
you
so,
got,
huh?
You got good sound, Peter.
Well.
You're going to miss all. Can you see us, Peter?
Yes, I can see everybody.
Oh, cool.
But I also clicked on the red leave button down at the lower right-hand corner. Nothing happens.
Well, that's, that's leaving this session.
I think I'm going to have to shut down my laptop completely and restart it, but I'm not going to do that now. I'll stay with you and read.
All right. Act 2, Scene 2. And Mike, if you would read the first Lord, and I will Simonides, since it looks like Paul had to exit the building. Okay? I'm going to be a king now. I'm going to be a king. Yay! I think it might work. I don't know. Are the knights ready to begin the triumph?
They are, my liege, and they are coming to present themselves.
Return them. They are ready. And our daughter, in honor of whose birth these triumphs are. And sets here, like beauty's child, whom nature got for men to see and seen wonder of.
It pleases you, my royal father, to express my commendations great, whose merits less.
It's fit it shouldn't be as so, but princes are a model, and which heavens might makes life itself. And as jewels lose their glory if neglected, so princes, their renown is respected. It is now your honor, daughter, to explain the labor of each knight in his device.
Which to preserve mine honor, I'll perform.
And, who is he that is first that doth prefer himself?
A knight of Sparta, my renowned father, and the device he bears upon his shield is a black Ethiop reaching at the sun. The word looks to a vita mihi.
He loves you, that well holds his life of you. And who is the second that presents himself?
A prince of Macedon, my royal father, and the device he bears upon his shield is an armed knight that's conquered by a lady. The motto thus in Spanish, Pue per dolere que per forza.
And what's the third?
The third of Antioch, and his device a wreath of chivalry. The word me pompae provexit ape.
And what is the fourth?
A burning torch that's turned it upside down. The word qui me alit me extinguit.
And what, which shows the beauty, hath his power and will, which can as well inflame as it can kill.
The fifth, and hand environed with clouds, holding out gold that's by the touchstone tried. The motto thus, sic spectanda fides.
And what's the sixth and the last? The which, the knight himself, which such a graceful courtesy delivered.
It seems to be a stranger, but his present is a withered branch that's only green at top. The motto, in hac spe vivo.
A pretty moral from the deleted state wherein he is. He hopes by you his fortunes yet may flourish.
He had need mean better than his outward show. Can any way speak in his just commend, or before by his rusty outside he appears to have practiced more of the whipstock than the lance?
He well may be a stranger, for he comes to an honored triumph strangely furnished.
And what second purpose is his armor rust lit by his stay to scour in the dust? Opinion's but a fool, and that makes us scan the outward habit by the inward man. But stay, the knights are coming, we'll withdraw into the gallery. We go to sing three.
The main knight! His main knight!
A knight, to say you're welcome were superfluous. To place upon the volume of your deeds, it is the title page, you're worth in arms. And we're more than you expect, or more than spit. And since every word to show commands itself, prepare for mirth becomes a man, a feast, and you are princes and my guests.
But you, my knight and guest, to whom this wreath of victory I give, and crown you king of this day's happiness.
'Tis more by fortune, lady, than by merit.
I call it by what you will. This place, this day, is yours, and here, I hope, is none that envies it. In training an artist, art hath thus decreed to make some good, but others to exceed, and you are her labored scholar. Come, queen of the feast, for daughter, so you are. And here, take your place, marshal the rest, that they deserve their grace.
You're honored much by good Simonides.
Ah, well, your presence glads our days. Honor we have, honor we love. For who hates honor hates the gods above. Honor, sir, yonder is your place.
Some other is more in it.
Yep, I'm two
C's. Contend not, sir, for we are gentlemen, and neither in our hearts nor outward eyes envy the great, nor do the low despise.
You are like courteous knights.
Well, sir, by love I wonder that is a king of thoughts, and he... These cates resist me, ye not thought upon.
My Juno, that is queen of marriage, all viands that I eat do seem unsavory, wishing him my meat. Sure, he's a gallant gentleman.
He's but a country gentleman. He has done no more than other the sights have done, and he has broken a staff of soul, and so let it pass.
He seems like diamond glass.
Yon king's to me like to my father's picture, which tells me in that glory way once he was. Had princes sit like stars about his throne, and he, the sun, for them to reverence. None that behold him but like the lesser lights did veil their crowns to his supremacy, which where now his sons like a glowworm in the night, which have fire in darkness, none in light, whereby I see that time is the king of men. He's both their parents, and he is their grave, and gives them what he will, and not what they crave.
What are you, married knights?
Who can be other in this royal presence?
Well, here, with a cup that's stored among the brim, as you do love, all to your mistress's lips, we'll drink this health to you.
We thank your grace.
Oh, you yet pause a while. You knight doth have a melancholy as the entertainment in our court had not a show might countervent his worth. Have you noted not you, Tyza?
What is to me, my father?
Oh, attend, my daughter. Pericles, in this should be the like gods above, who merely give to everyone that comes to honor them. And princes not during the like to goss, to goats, to gnats. And my eyes are going, which makes a sound, but killed are wondered at. And therefore, to make his entertain more sweet, here say we drink this standing bowl of wine to him.
Alas, my father, it befits not me unto a stranger knight to be so bold. He may my proffer take for an offense, since men take women's gifts for impudence.
How? Do as I bid you, or you'll move me else.
Oh, by the gods, you could not please me better.
And furthermore, tell him we desire to know of him, of whence he is, his name, and his parentage.
The king, my father, sir, has drunk to you.
Thank him.
Wishing it so much blood unto your life.
I thank both him and you, and pledge him freely.
And further, he desires to know of you, of whence you are, your name and parentage.
Oh, a gentleman of Tyre, my name Pericles. My education has been arts and arms, who, looking for adventures in this world, was by the rough seas, bereft of ships and men, and after shipwreck, driven upon the shore.
He thanks your grace, names himself Pericles, a gentleman of Tyre, who, only by misfortune of the seas, bereft of ships and men, passed on the shore.
Mm-hmm.
Now, by the gods, I pity his misfortune, and will wake him with his melancholy. Come, gentlemen, we sit too long on trifles, and waste the time which looks for other revels. Even in your armors, as you are addressed, will very well become a soldier's dance. I will not have excuse. With saying this, and loud music is too harsh for ladies' heads. And since they love men in arms as well as in beds. Both of arms. Come, sir, here is a lady that wants breathing too. And I have heard you, Knights of Tyre, are excellent in making ladies trip, and that your measures are as excellent.
Oh, in the practice them they are, my lord.
Ah, so that's as much as you would be denied of your fair courtesy. Mm-hmm. Unclasp. Thanks, gentlemen, to all. All have done well. But you are the best, sir, and pages and knights to conduct these knights unto their several lodgings. Endure, sir, we have given order to be next to our own.
I am at your gracious pleasure.
Princes, it is too late to talk of love, and that's the mark I know you have leveled at. And therefore, each one betake him to his rest, and tomorrow all the speeding do their best.
Exeunt.
Exeunt. Scene 4, a room in the governor's house. Alicanus.
No, Escanes, know this of me. Antiochus, from incest, lived not free, for which the most high gods, not minding longer to withhold the vengeance that they had in store, due to his heinous capital offense, even in the height and pride of all his glory, when he was seated in a chariot of an inestimable value, and his daughter with him, a fire from heaven came and shriveled up their bodies, even to loathing, for they so stunk that all those eyes adored them ere their fall, scorn now their hand should give them burial.
And it was very strange.
And yet, but justice, for though the king were great, his greatness was no guard to bar heaven's shaft, but sin had his reward.
Tis very true.
See, another man in private conference or council has respect with him but he.
It no longer grieve without reproof.
And curse be he that will not second it.
Follow me then. Lord Helicane, a word.
With me? And welcome. Happy day, my lords.
Know that our griefs are risen to the top, and now at length they overflow their banks.
Your griefs? For what? Wrong not your prince you love.
Wrong not yourself then, nor noble Helicane, but if the prince do live, let us salute him, or know what grounds made happy by his breath. If in the world he lives, we'll seek him out. If in his grave he rests, we'll find him there, and be resolved. He lives to govern us, or dead gives cause to mourn his funeral, and leaves us to our free election.
Whose death indeed's the strongest in our censure, and knowing his kingdom is without a head, like goodly buildings left without a roof, soon fall to ruin. Your noble self, what best know how to rule and how to reign, we thus submit unto our sovereign. For honor's cause, forbear your suffrages. For if that you love Prince Pericles, forbear. I take your wish. I leap into the seas, where hourly's trouble for a minute's ease. A twelfth-month longer, yet let me entreat to you two, forbear the absence of your king. If, in which time expired, he not return, I shall, aged patience, bear your yoke. But if I cannot win you to this love, go search like noble subjects, and your search spend your adventure's worth, whom if you find and win unto return, you shall like diamonds sit about his crown.
To wisdom is a fool that will not yield, and since Lord Melican joineth us, we with our travels will endeavor it.
Then you love us, we you, and we'll clasp hands. When peers thus knit, a kingdom ever stands.
And the king returns. First night.
Good morrow to the good Simonides. Simonides.
And nights from my daughter, this I let you know, that for this 12 months, she'll not undertake a married life. And her reason to herself is only known, which yet from her by no means can I guess.
May we not get access to, or who's second? I'm sorry, am I saying?
By no means. And one that she hath so strictly tied her to the chamber that 'tis impossible. The 1/12 of 12 moons there she wear Diana's livery. And this by the eye of Cynthia hath she vowed, that her virgin honor will not break it.
And loath of her bid farewell, she must take our leaves.
So they are well dispatched. Now to my daughter's letter. She tells me here she'll wed the stranger knight, or never more to view nor day nor light. 'Tis well, mistress, your choice agrees with mine. I like that well. Nay, how absolute she's in it, not minding whether I like you, dislike or not. And will I commend her choice, and will no longer have it as be she delayed. And soft, if he comes, I must dissemble it.
All fortune to the good Simonides.
Ah, so well good to your as much, sir. And I am beholden to you for our sworn sweet music this last night. I do protest my ears were never better fed by any delightfully pleasing harmony.
It is your gracious pleasures to commend, not my dessert.
Ah, sir, you are music's master.
The worst of all our scholars, my good lord.
Let me ask you one thing. What do you think of my daughter, sir?
A most virtuous princess.
She is fair, too, is she not?
As fair day in summer, wondrous fair.
Sir, my daughter thinks very well of you, and so well that you must be her master. And she will be your scholar. Therefore, look to it.
I am unworthy to borrow schoolmaster.
Well, she thinks not so, and peruse this writing else.
What's here? A letter that she loves the knight of Tyre? To the king's subway to have my life, seek not to entreat me, gracious lord. A stranger and a distressed gentleman that never aimed so high as to love his daughter, but bent all offices to honor her.
Thou hast bewitched my daughter, and thou art a villain.
Oh, by the gods, I have not. Never did thought of mine levy offense, nor never did my actions yet commence. A deed might gain her love to or her displacement.
Traitor, thou liest.
Traitor?
Aye, traitor.
Even in his breath, even in his throat, unless it be the king that calls me traitor. I return the lie.
Now, by the gods, I do applaud this courage.
My actions are noble in my thoughts, that never relished in a base descent. I came unto your court for honor's cause, and not to be rebel to her state. And he that otherwise accounts of me, this sword shall prove his honor's enemy.
No? Well, here comes my daughter. She can witness it.
Then, as you are virtuous as fair, resolve your angry father, if my tongue did e'er solicit, or my hand subscribe to any syllable that hath made love to you.
Why, sir, say if you had. Who takes offense at that would make me glad?
Fair mistress, are you so peremptory? Aside, I am glad on it with all my heart. I'll tame you. I'll bring you in subjection. Will you not, having more my consent, bestow your king and your affection upon a stranger? For aught I know, maybe, and I think that contrary, as great as blood as I myself. And therefore, hear you, mistress, either frame your will to mine, and you, sir, hear you, either to be ruled by me, or I'll make you, must seal it true, and bring joined, I'll thus your hopes destroy. And that's for further grief, God give you joy. What are you both pleased?
Yes, if you love me, sir.
Even as my life, my blood that fosters it.
What are you both agreed?
Yes, if it please your majesty.
And it pleases me so well that I will see you well, and then with what haste you can get to you to bed.
Now sleep, he slacketh at the rout. No din but snores about this house, made louder by the o'erfed breast of this most pompous marriage feast. The cat with bine of burning coal now couches from the mouse's hole, and crickets sing at the oven's mouth are the blither for their draught. Flaming brought the bride to bed, whereby the loss of maidenhead a babe is molded. The tent and time that is so briefly spent with your fine fancies quaintly each its dumb and show complete such. By many a dern and painful perch of Pericles, the careful search by the four opposing coins which the world together joins is made with all due diligence that horse and sail and high expense can stead the quest. At last, from Tyre, fame answering the most strange inquire, to the court of King Simonides are letters brought, the tenor these. Said his daughter dead. The men of Tyrus on the head of Helicanus would set on the crown of Tyre, but he will none. Mutiny he there hastes to press, says to him, if King Pericles come not home in twice 6 moons, he, obedient to their dooms, will take the crown. The son of this, brought hither to Pentapolis, he ravished the regions round, and everyone with claps can sound, our heir apparent is a king. Who dreamt, who thought of such a thing? Grief, he must hence depart to Tyre. His queen with child makes her desire, which who shall cross, along to him. Omit we all their dole and woe. Like Corrida, her nurse she takes, and so to sea. The vessel shakes on Neptune's billow. Half the flood hath their keel cut, but fortune moved varies again. The grizzled north disgorges such a tempest forth that as a duck for life that dives, so up and down the poor ship drives. The lady shrieks, and well and near doth fall in travail with her fear. And what ensues in this fell storm shall for itself perform. I will relate. Action may conveniently the rest convey, which might not what by me is told. In your imagination hold this stage, the ship upon whose deck the sea-tossed Pericles appears to speak.
And with that, let us take a minute or two to figure out what happened to Pericles, black screen and all.